Hello there, technology fans. This is Ham Radio Now, episode 223 from the ARRL and TAPR Digital Communications Conference in Chicago back in October 2015. Okay, we are in the all TAPR, all the time mode, at least for a few episodes, because I got four of them teed up to go as I do these introductions and then get them online. And this one is John Ackermann, N8UR. Hang on a sec, I got a little picture of John here. Well, a little picture of him. There he is in the editor. The name of the program is TASS. At least that's what it says here in the event program, TASS. The problem is I don't know what TASS means. And when I talked to Steve Bible doing sort of the preview of things back last summer, he didn't know what TASS meant either. Something like totally awesome something switch. Let me see if I've got something a little closer to that. Well, here's what John is calling it. The high performance RF switch for lab and ham shack. So, and he still says TASS, and I looked at the beginning of the program, and he still doesn't say what it is, at least in the first couple of minutes. Maybe somewhere along the line he would. So anyway, it's TASS, or High Performance RF Switch, as John will explain, a project that he initially had a need for and then decided to design and build, and it went out of control, and now it's a kit. And if you've got a need for high performance RF, actually not just RF, it goes all the way down to, well, DC, it's little relays. In a multi relay switch box that is controlled by a processor, and very, very cool and useful, and something that you can build because it's now a TAPR kit. We'll get to that in just a moment. I do need to remind you that Ham Radio Now and the TAPR conference is brought to you by you. Arvin is sitting back there telling me, whispering in my ear, that because the Kickstarter, which we ran last summer to fund taking me and all of this stuff, this stuff and the cameras and all that stuff, the Kickstarter that was going to take me out to Chicago and pay for all of this stuff, failed. Epic fail. We had about $6,500 worth of pledges toward a $10,000 goal, and Kickstarter is an all or nothing thing. So I didn't get the 6,500. I didn't get the 10,000. I got zero goose egg, not a big, you know, bump on the line. But a lot of you folks said, well, we still want you to go. And I've gotten a lot of contributions from people who are eagerly anticipating the programs, but it hasn't quite covered the nut yet. So if you're interested in these programs, if you find out you're getting something from them, please stop by. What it says right down here, hamradionow.tv, click on Arvin. Arvin, yeah, there he is on the left-hand side. Click on Arvin and you can make a contribution. Perhaps you would like to join the Patreon. Let's see. I believe I've got the up here. Yes, on the browser, there's Arvin and his icon. You can click on that or you can click directly on the Patreon. The Patreon is a monthly contribution. Sign up for that. $1 a month would be cool, especially if we got several thousand people doing it. Right now we have a few hundred. And that helps support what we're doing here, because this is pretty much, I was going to say it's full-time work for me. I put in about 10 to 20 hours a week on this, so it's part-time work. But I still need to make enough money to make it worthwhile. So help me out, hamradionow.tv, and either an individual contribution through PayPal or something on the Patreon. Did you catch the Easter egg, the big goof at the beginning of episode 222 when I announced it as 221? This is Ham Radio Now, episode 221, On the Road Again. And the title below it, it was the generic thing that I have in my title system, you know, month and date. So wasn't quite filled in. Yeah, sometimes that stuff gets ahead of me. I'm going to be putting out the TAPR conference programs as fast as I can. Like I said, I've got four of them pretty much ready to go. Just need to record some more introductions and get them online. And if you're watching this in near real time, you know, today is December 7th. It is Monday. They should start pouring out by the end of today. You'll start seeing them on Tuesday, December 8th, and be able to watch those four. And then I'll get to doing as many as I can after that. There are a few other things I want to get squeezed into the middle of this stuff, some things that have been going on in the ham radio world that would be good to cover. So I'm going to try to probably squeeze a couple things in. But most of my time is going to be doing the tapper things until they are all out there for you. So let's head to Chicago and the Tapper Digital Communications Conference. Our leadoff speaker for Friday morning, 9 a.m. And Steve Bible, if you will do the honors. And don't mess this up.
All right. Introducing John Ackermann. What's your call sign?
N8UR.
A high-performance RF switch lab for the Ham Shack. Take it away, John.
Yeah. Thanks, Steve. We don't actually talk on the radio very much, as you can tell. So this is the story of a digression, and I think many of you have had this sort of thing happen. I know yesterday it happened kind of entirely during the Tapper board meeting, where you start talking about something simple like whether we have enough paper for the printer, and you end up talking about the future of the organization, and it just sort of gets strange that way. Those of you who know me know that I'm interested in time and frequency measurement, and I take that to sort of an extreme, and I've got racks full of oscillators and counters and stuff. And over the years, I've been putting together a system that would let me measure a whole bunch of frequency standards against something like a GPS over long, long periods of time. And it's all computer controlled, and I've got some remote controlled switches that were surplus from Hewlett Packard, made in the 70s or 80s, and rated for probably 50 million cycles, and have probably had 300 million by now. And they've started to fail. And back in February, I noticed one of them was failing, and I was getting some lousy data. So I decided, okay, I'm going to open it up and fix it. Well, I opened it up and looked at the schematic and discovered you can't fix them. They're made with sealed two-stage relays that you just can't find anywhere. So I said, I will design my own. And thus, my whole project for measuring stuff stopped. And for the next 6 months, I set out designing a switch. And it turned into a little bit bigger project than anticipated, but I think the outcome is something that's not only really useful, and it's useful to more groups than I originally thought. You know, I was trying to solve my problem, which was switching pulse per second signals. Well, it turns out there are a whole bunch of other problems that we can solve with a switch like this as well. So I ended up with something that hopefully will be useful to a lot of people. And I'm going to talk a little bit about the switch. And if you really are interested in the details, we have documentation published at the Tapper site. I also did a 7-minute video introduction, which is actually going to be the same slides as much as what you're going to see here, and probably better presented. So if you really want to understand how the thing works and how it's used, I recommend that you look at the video, which is available on YouTube as well as from the Tapper site. And so we'll see if the page turning mechanism works. Okay, this is the TASS switch. The two pictures on the left are the front and the back of the circuit board that's the actual RF switch. It's 8 BNC connectors connected into 2 buses, and I'll talk a little bit more about that architecture in a minute. On the back side, there are 9 relays. The extra relay is there for purposes of magic. And it's a very simple, in terms of component layout, turned out not quite so simple to actually build and make work, and that's part of the journey. Along the way, I decided that instead of trying to put any kind of controller logic on the board itself, I'd use something else, and the something else ended up being an Arduino. And that was an incredibly important decision, and it's opened up a lot of opportunities. So the upper right-hand picture is a shield that we put together that goes onto an Arduino Mega 2560 processor, which is a regular Arduino, except that it's got like 54 digital IOs instead of 15. So it's got a lot more capability to just turn stuff on and off. And then in the lower right was just for fun, because in the Arduino community, there are people making all sorts of crap. You know, you can get these shield boards that plug in and do everything. For about $40, I could get a 2.8-inch touchscreen. And I said, I'll get one of those and see what I can do with it. And I've never programmed graphics before in my life. It took about a day and a half over a weekend, and I have a touchscreen interface that can control four boards and do all the relay switching and stuff. And so the lower right-hand picture is a demo of just that touchscreen running. And some people may find the touchscreen useful. I thought it was more interesting just to show how easy it is to expand and do other things with the board because of all of this other capability that's been built into the Arduino ecosystem. So the switch itself has 8 RF ports. It's a very simple interface, and I'll describe how that works in a minute. But again, there's no intelligence on the board. The IC chip that you see is simply a relay driver. And there's a 10-pin header. 9 of those pins connect to relays through the relay driver. You put a high voltage on a pin and that relay turns on. That is all that's on the board. There's no other intelligence at all. It works from DC to 150 megs. And there was a lot of discussion among my friends at the beginning, why don't you use pin diodes? Why don't you do this? Why don't you do that? Well, when you want to cover both DC and VHF, mechanical relays are about the only thing that actually work. So I had to shut down a lot of really great ideas and just focus on the simple mechanical switch, but it gives us the performance. It's very good through 150 megs. It falls apart above that, and I can talk about why if you're interested, other than that RF isn't as easy as it looks. And we do have one thing that we've tried really hard for is high isolation. So there's about 70 dB of isolation between the adjacent ports on the switch, so you have very, very little crosstalk. And for some applications, like my original one, that was really important. It's not a high power switch. Please do not put this after your alpha. It's rated at 10 watts, and the 10 watt rating is actually not because of the relays, not because of the components, but we had to use an actual 50 ohm microstrip in a 4-layer board, and 10 watts is the amount of power that the copper can handle before it starts to heat up too much. And it runs off of 12 volts. The shield on the Arduino side is more of a convenience than anything. It simply is a shield that's designed to fit on the 2560 processor, and it brings out the outputs out of 4 10-pin headers. Each header can control one relay board. So with this, with one Arduino and the TASS shield, you can connect 4 boards and do all sorts of interesting switching things. The application that I'm building at home actually will use all 4 boards. I'll have a matrix with 16 switches for inputs, 8 switches for reference, and then you can route the selected signals to any one of 4 time interval counters on the back side. So a total of 32 ports, all controlled by the Arduino. The software is all open source. It's written in the Arduino development environment, and I'll talk a little bit more about that later. Currently, it supports USB, the native Arduino communication via USB. It also supports Ethernet, so you can plug this thing into an Ethernet, and it acts like a simple Telnet terminal and issue the commands. And it also has the touchscreen interface. This is what the commands look like, and maybe I will step over, Gary, and see if I can. Except I'm not going to be on the mic. Can you hear me? Well enough? So it's a simple command structure of a left bracket, then 3 characters. The first character is A, B, C, or D for the board. The second character is 1 through 8 for the relay that you've selected, and the third character is the set, unset, or hold the that relay, and then a right bracket close. Gary, do I need to repeat all that, or?
No, you're okay.
Okay. And The terminal software will echo back the command, and the relays go clickety-click, and it's not really all that exciting, but it does what it's supposed to do. And this is just a capture of a terminal screen running that shows some of the commands that I issued and the results that you get back. But the idea was to have a command structure that would be very easy for a computer to provide. And my original application with those old HP switches, they talked the very first, earliest, brain-dead version of HPIB before it became GPIB, and you basically sent an A1 to turn a relay on, and it didn't even respond with anything. If you were lucky, you just heard a click. And this isn't much smarter than that, but for what we're trying to do, it doesn't need to be. And of course, with the Arduino, you can rewrite that. All of this command logic is in the Arduino. The board itself, again, all you do is put a logic high on a pin, and the relay associated with that pin turns on. So this is all just within the Arduino. This is the architecture, and it's just, you know, two buses, each with four relays and four BNC connectors. And you can turn each of the switches on independently. So if you wanted, in the simplest case, just turn on relay one and leave it on, and that becomes your common, and then select relay two, three, or four, and you now have a three-pole switch. You can do the same thing on the other side. So you can have a double pole switch, or they can act completely independently. Because again, each relay does its own thing. We've also brought out external pads so that you can use an external BNC or whatever you'd like as the common. Now, if you have a BNC connector on one of those pads that are circled in red, that's your common, and now instead of a three-way switch, you have a four-way switch. So just a simple way to extend it. You can also use this to extend multiple boards together. Daisy chain, two buses, and now you have eight switches in a bus instead of four. So that will let you expand the switch. There is an RF performance cost in doing that. Because the way this is designed, any unused switch beyond the ones that you've selected creates an open stub. And at VHF, that starts to matter, and the high frequency performance will fall off. But at 30 megs or below, you could probably chain three boards together before you notice anything significant. But if you're trying to put 2 meters through it, daisy chaining the boards may be a problem. I mentioned the ninth relay that was there for magic. What this relay does is allow you to make a true 8-port switch. Again, you use an external connector for the common. It goes through that relay, and the Arduino software will automatically flip that relay depending on the port that you've selected. So if you want to use antenna 1 on port 1, the relay will stay in the position shown. If you select relay 5, relay 5 will be turned on, but relay the K9, ninth relay, will also flip to follow. So now, by using that, you have a true 8-port switch. And that there are a couple of other ways that you could create 8 ports, but this is the one that works the best. It gives the best RF performance. So the simplest application, I already mentioned this, is you could have two radios that each go to three antennas. And yeah, that's not very fancy or complicated, but it might be useful. Now, by using the extra relay, we can have the 8-port antenna. I'm sorry, the 8-port switch. You can set this up as a double pole four throw switch. So now you can start putting filters or preamps or whatever other devices that you'd like, and you can track both sides of the switch through the software. So I can issue one command for 2 meters, and it will turn on relays 1 and 5, which will now give me a path through to that 2-meter filter, if that's the configuration I wanted. So again, lots and lots of flexibility, and almost all of that comes from the fact that all the work is being done in the Arduino and nothing is being done on the board. The board becomes a very generic piece of hardware. And that's really an important learning that came out of this project, was make the board as simple as possible, because then it can do more things than it could if I'd been a lot more clever in putting stuff on the relay board itself. Now, I mentioned before, we can daisy chain the switches together and create larger switches. Again, there's an RF performance issue, but for my use case where I'm sending pulse per second signals, it doesn't matter. I could have five of these things strung together without any issues. So just again, lots of flexibility possible depending on how you drive it with the software. And so this is the end of the sales pitch. We are shipping the kits right now. They're available from TAPR. I think the TASS R board is $119 and the shield is $19. They're kits, there's no surface mount components. It does take a little bit of skill to get all the connectors mounted solidly and to get things even, but it's not that difficult to do. If I can do it, anyone can do it. And we have lots of documentation. The open source software, the doc file, which also has some performance information. Because I'm me, first thing I did after I proved that the relays clicked on and off was I put it on the network analyzer to see how well it worked. So we have some plots of the performance there. And we also have the 7-minute video that's available either from the TAPR site or it's also on YouTube. So now, a few thoughts about this project, because as I said, it started out being, damn switch is broken, I gotta figure out a way to replace it. Feeping creaturism is a serious problem in amateur as well as professional engineering. And I have friends, and I have friends who are very smart, and I have friends who are very smart and have lots of ideas. And ultimately, I had to just tell them to shut up. Because the list of things ended up getting longer and longer, and the possibility of actually building it became less and less. But again, what was really critical was this decision to move the logic off the board. Because once I did that, I could focus on the RF bit about making sure that worked, and I didn't need to worry about hardwiring any design decisions. Everything could be done within the Arduino software. And this is the first time I've ever done a project like that, and it really is kind of amazing. And I'll show you in a minute. There's a couple of uses for this switch that came up after we finished it, and that I had never thought of, but are very easy to implement because of that design structure. I will mention again, RF is hard. TAPR learned that with some radio projects we tried to do back years ago, and I relearned it in simply trying to make a stupid little switch. Because it turns out that with the four BNCs in a row on a bus, if you have relays one and four selected, well, you can get pretty decent performance if you use something that looks like 50 ohms in between. But if you select relays one and two, now you have that piece of copper that would go to relays three and four sticking out there. And the maximum length is like 3 inches. And depending on the configuration, it's less than that. 3 inches is important. At VHF, it's really important. And 50 ohms is also important. When I first laid out the traces, I kind of did my usual, well, I want to make them as fat as I can to have as little loss as I can. And the frequency response was just awful. Just a terrible, terrible thing. So I had to go back and learn a bunch of things that I had never learned before. And we ended up building this on a 4-layer board with actual calculated 50-ohm strip lines inside to maximize the performance. And once we did that, it worked very well. But the first take, the loss as well as the SWR at frequency was just appalling. So RF takes work. And it can be done, but I think many of us sort of assume that it acts like DC, and it doesn't. On the other hand, Arduino is easy. The IDE works well, and I have to tell you, I've been farting around with programming for a long, long, long time. C and C++ have always scared me a lot. The concept of the pointer just makes my brain explode. So I've never been comfortable in C. Arduino uses a C++ kind of environment. It has some unique issues of its own, but things are well enough documented, and there's so much sample code out there that I actually was able to get my initial code that made the relays click running in less than a weekend from a ground zero, how do I install the IDE, to having it functional very quickly. So it is really easy to use. And as I mentioned, there are all of these things that are out there. You know, the touchscreen, I saw it on Adafruit, said, I'm gonna get me one of those. And you know, a weekend later, after having never done any graphics, I had the touchscreen working. When I decided to add Ethernet, that took an afternoon because there's an Ethernet library. And the hardest part, and I'll mention this again, was you'd think that the first thing that somebody putting Ethernet on an Arduino would do would say, I'd like to emulate the serial port that's on the USB so you can talk to it and it talks back. No one had done that. There were all sorts of web servers and other interesting crap, but the basic command parser kind of interface didn't exist. So most of my time was just the basic client server, you know, like a telnet server bit, which is still only 20 or 30 lines of code, but I couldn't find anybody who had done that 20 or 30 lines of code, which was a bit frustrating. Wi-Fi, you know, why not? I've got the shield, I plan to put that in, and that has some interesting ideas, particularly if you'd like RF isolation, or I'm sorry, DC isolation between your antenna system and the rest of the shack, use Wi-Fi, now you don't have any copper connecting the systems together. And if you want to do Bluetooth or Zigbee or whatever other weird protocol somebody's doing out there, I presume you could get a photo sensor shield and control it by Morse code with a flashlight. Don't see any reason why not. So it's an extremely interesting platform given the possibilities that it opens and the other stuff that you can do with it. As I mentioned, there are some gotchas in the Arduino environment, and one of them is the examples. There's lots and lots of stuff out there, but it's doing weird things, and there's not a lot of some of the basic core, you know, programmable device kind of thing that you'd like. I spent a ridiculous amount of time trying to find a command parser that would let me, you know, send it the 5-character string, test for valid characters, and send the final product through. Again, it wasn't that hard to write. I spent more time trying to find an example online than it took me to when I finally gave up and started writing it myself. And there's contradictory advice. There's a string library as part of the Arduino environment. If you look online, it appears the main purpose of the string library is for people to tell you not to use it. And again, I do most of my stuff in Perl or Python or something where there is an assumption that you use characters put together, which C is not willing to accept. And just having to figure that stuff out and try to find advice on some of the basics for somebody who's literate in programming but not in the language was a bit challenging. And then finally, and this is more for the geeks than normal people, the build environment isn't quite standard. It has the processor directives and include files and all that kind of stuff, but they work in a different way because the Arduino preprocessor does its own thing. So some things, when I tried to move some things into a file to make things cleaner, it didn't work. Or there's a magic line that you have to put in order to keep the preprocessor happy. I guess it's sort of like the NSA line eater that we used to all think we had to put in emails. If you put this magic widget in and everything works fine, you take it out and stuff blows up. So it still takes a little bit of playing around, but in general, it's just kind of remarkable how much you can do how quickly. And if you haven't played with an Arduino, I suggest you give it a try because it's cheap and it's a lot of fun. And again, the hardware, yeah, first of all, it is cheap. You can find an Arduino Nano, which is the one that doesn't have any headers or pins on it, just the raw processor. And they're like $3 from China. It's just absurd.
got them for $1.75 from China.
So Bruce is a bargain hunter. He held out for the $1.75 version. But the R3 is sort of the standard Arduino, and that's what I started with. It's got about 16 IOs. But the problem is, even though that seemed like a lot, by the time you'd leave the capability to add the Wi-Fi, the touchscreen, et cetera, those use up 6 or 7 IOs if you want to have all that stuff working. So the R3 did not leave me quite enough simple IO to be able to run the 9 pins for the switch plus the other stuff. And I thought to myself, okay, I will just lay out some logic on a shield that does the encoding so I can maybe get down to 4 or 5 pins to control my 9 relays. And I started doing that and, you know, all the, got out the old TTL handbooks and figured out the logic gates and everything. And then I just realized that the cost of those parts was significantly more than the cost of going from an R3 to the Mega 2560, which gave me 52 IOs for like $10 more than the R3. And so now the TASS shield board doesn't have a single part on it. It's nothing but headers. And it just brings the signals out on, so that I can connect them with ribbon cable. So it was literally cheaper to go with a bigger Arduino than it was to wire up a handful of logic chips. So it's, again, an interesting and different way to look at the world. I will say that Bruce's $1.79 Nano probably came from somewhere that's not precisely licensed to use the code or the trademarks, which it does use as well. And the build quality is just hugely, hugely variable. You go to Amazon, and you cannot actually find, of the hundreds of Arduinos that are listed, one that you know is actually the Arduino build. They're all by other people. And I got one board that literally had lots and lots of rosin flux all over the board. I suspect that they built it using a blowtorch. And it did work. I give them that. But the quality is just remarkably variable. I have found that there's one of the Chinese companies is called SainSmart, SainSmart. And everything I've gotten from them has been pretty good. It's relatively low cost, but the build quality seems to be good, and they work well. I'm seeing a couple of other people who've said the same thing. So I mentioned that we've come up with new use cases since we finished designing the board, and a lot of it is because of using the Arduino as a separate component. So after I announced the thing to the HPSDR list, somebody said, well, gee, can this talk to a Hermes or an NN board? I said, well, you know, I have a Hermes, and I've done things with it, but I never actually even thought about that. Well, it turns out, and I'm not putting this schematic up as actually something that anyone could build right now. It's missing a couple of ground pads and things. But with one IC and a transistor, you can build an interface that will let you use 5 of the open collector pins on the Hermes to control all 8 ports on the TAS switch. So I'm going to, if not make this as a one-time buy, because I don't think there's enough interest for volume, I'll at least make the Gerbers and the schematics available. It's going to be very easy to build. But you can interface the TAS switch without using the Arduino. You don't need any intermediate processor. But with this circuit, you could interface the switch directly to a Hermes or NN board and get all that extra switching capability. So that was something we never even thought of. And then the other thing was that when I started designing it, I wanted to come up with a use that was not just for time nuts, because I thought the time nuts only would really limit the interest. And I thought, you know, there's probably a use for VHF guys to use this for switching transverters and that kind of thing. And so I talked about that and told a few of my VHF friends, and they thought it was an interesting idea. Well, just last night, after the board meeting, I was talking with Kermit and Bruce, and we figured out that, gee, there is more capability here than we thought, because if you stick one of these boards in an enclosure with the touchscreen control, I'm using one of the 10-pin ribbon headers with 9 IOs to run the relays. I have 3 more ribbon headers, each with 9 IOs available that aren't doing anything at all. Let's bring those out to a couple of DB9s on the back panel, and now you can use those to control push to talk, power selection, all the other stuff that you'd want. So this becomes a single point rover controller for all the transverters and switching that you need to do. This thing could be the single controller, have the touchscreen program so that it's 6, 2, 4, 32, whatever. Push the button on the touchscreen, everything else switches, and you're on the air. And I'd never even thought about that expanded capability until last night. So there's just a lot that can come out of a simple damn switch. So that's it. I do have an example. I went to Front Panel Express and had them make an enclosure. The enclosure cost about twice what all the guts cost, but it looks cool. So this is a TASS with the relay board mounted in the back, the Arduino and shield in the front, and a touchscreen for control on the front. I'll have this running over in the demo room, and you can push buttons, and I'll have some blinking lights that you can watch. So if anybody wants to play with it, that'll be available in the demo room a bit later on. But that's it, friends. I wanted to tell you about the product because I hope we sell some of them because we spent a lot of money on inventory. But I also wanted to talk about the process and evolution of a project, you know, coming out of a broken switch to something that's a complete environment that, you know, I hadn't even thought I needed until I had it. So thanks much, and glad to talk to you all offline more about it if you'd like.
John, can I just ask a quick question?
Yes.
Over here?
Over here, yeah.
What does hold do?
I'm sorry?
What does the H command do for the relays? Oh. You've got S and U, and I don't understand what H
okay.
is.
Okay, so thanks. And the question is, there are 3 commands, hold, set, and unset. The set command will turn a relay on and keep it on until you select another relay. So it allows you to toggle. The hold command will turn the relay on and keep it on until you explicitly turn it off. So if you do hold 1, that can now become your common. And then you can do set 2, set 3, set 4, and they'll automatically cycle. So the S command lets you just use a single command to change from one relay to the other without having to issue a turn off and then a separate turn on.
Thanks.
Mm-hmm. Anything else? Yeah, thanks, folks.
Can we get one more question in here? This, perhaps I missed the whole point, but would this be suitable for switching audio?
Yes.
If we wanted to?
Yeah.
Okay, because we got a repeater control system, and our controller's kind of getting about 30 years old, and we're talking new. So we could put on... Okay, that answers my question.
Yeah, because it's just relay contact, so anything from DC through 150 megs will go through there just fine.
Okay.
Thank you.
Mm-hmm.
John, any issues with 10 watts going through the board, giving any RF problems to the Arduino?
Have not seen that yet, but I suspect a lot has to do with how you physically position things. The ground on the board is, there's lots and lots of copper that's all RF ground. The control loop is isolated. So you've got basically 12 volts in and 12 volt return, but they're completely isolated from the copper ground on the rest of the board. So that hopefully will insulate from noise. But I suspect that probably putting a ferrite or two on the ribbon cable wouldn't be a bad idea. But I haven't done or been all that interested in extensive EMI testing, but maybe Tom can do that for us.
Okay.
We got to move on. Thank you for the questions. And will you have your stuff set up in the demo room?
Yes, I will.
Okay.
Hi, I'm John Ackermann, N8UR, and I'd like to introduce you to the TASS RF switch. It's a project I've been working on for the last few months, and the TAPR is now going to offer as a kit. As part of my time and frequency experiments, I measure multiple sources such as frequency standards or clock outputs with a counter and log the data to disk. I want to use a computer to automatically switch from one signal to another for each round of measurements. Sometimes I'm testing a batch of four or five devices against three or four reference signals, so I need multiple switches, each with a bunch of ports. In the past, I used some surplus HP switches, and they worked really well, but those switches are now several decades old and are starting to fail. I found that you just can't get replacement parts, so I decided to design a more modern switch system using a combination of a relay board and a small processor, such as an Arduino, to provide the logic. The TASS is the result. We think it is useful not only in a laboratory, but also in a ham shack or wherever you want to route multiple RF or audio signals between sources. The TASS relay board has 8 BNC connectors, and it's 2.2 by 4.4 inches in size. It'll mount into a 2U rack panel. The connectors are arranged in two groups of four. Each group has a common bus. Between each connector and the bus is a relay. Pins on a 10-pin header control a set of relay drivers. A 2 to 5 volt signal on a pin turns on its associated relay. The switch is designed to operate from DC to 150 MHz with low insertion loss and a good SWR. We paid a lot of attention in the design to high isolation between the ports, so crosstalk is minimized. The board is designed to handle about 10 watts of RF power. It's not intended to follow a big amplifier. The TASR uses 12 volts DC at from 15 to 150 milliamps, depending on how many relays are energized. Because the TASS relay board does not have any intelligence, it needs an external controller. Any simple microcontroller will work, a PIC chip, AVR, Arduino, Raspberry Pi, whatever, as long as it provides at least 9 digital output lines. We decided to use the Arduino, and I designed a daughter board, or shield in Arduino speak, that will support up to 4 TASS relay boards simultaneously. We cleverly call this the TASS shield. It mounts onto an Arduino Mega 2560 processor. We use that version because it has enough I.O. pins to control 4 boards, with pins left over for other uses. The TASS software was written in the Arduino development environment. It's open source, free to download, modify, and use however you'd like, and currently it provides USB and Ethernet connections to a host computer. The commands are simple ASCII strings. Just for fun, we also created a touchscreen interface. It uses a simple TFT screen that's available from Adafruit for about $45, and creates a fully functional standalone system, although it's not quite as flexible as using the PC-hosted commands. Here's a screenshot of a terminal program on my PC talking to an Arduino that's running the TASS controller software. The commands are 3 ASCII characters, surrounded by left and right arrow characters as delimiters. The first character selects the board, the second character selects the relay, and the third character is the command. The H, or hold command, will turn a relay on and keep it on until it's explicitly turned off. Typically, you use the H command to set the common port on a bus. The S, or set command, will turn a relay on, but will reset that relay when another S command is issued. This allows you to toggle between relays with only a single command. The U, or unhold command, will turn off a relay that's been either set or held. If you select relay 0, that will clear all the relays on the board, turning everything off. Here's a bare-bones schematic of the TASS relay board. You can see how the connectors are grouped into two buses. By selecting relays, you can route, for example, the signal at port 1 to port 3, or the signal at port 5 to port 8. Each relay is controlled separately, so you can turn on any combination of the 8 ports. This provides great flexibility and allows for many different configurations. The relay board also has pads that allow you to extend each of the two buses. These could be used, for example, to put an external common connection for each bus on a panel. That allows you to have 4 switched ports in each group. These connection points can also be used for other purposes, as I'll describe a bit later. 3 or 4 ports often aren't as many as we would like to have in a switching system, so the TASR board is designed to allow all the ports to be routed to a single external common connector, making it a true 8-way switch. This is done through an additional relay that toggles the external connector between the two buses. The TASS software can automatically switch this relay based on the port number entered in a command, so the PC program doesn't have to do any extra work. This drawing shows perhaps the simplest configuration for the TASS relay board. There are 2 independent 3-way switches allowing, for example, 2 radios to each connect to one of 3 antennas. This configuration doesn't use any external connections at all. This is an example showing how the toggle relay can be used to create an 8-pole switch. Because the two sets of connectors and relays on the TASS-R board operate independently, we can configure them to act as a double-pole switch with the ports on both buses switched simultaneously. This functionality is programmed into the TASS controller software. Here's an example showing how that capability could be used to put bandpass filters between an antenna and a receiver. The extension ports on each of the buses can also be used to daisy-chain ports together to create even larger switches. In this example, the buses of two boards are connected together. The controller software is configured to assume each bus has 8 ports. Using the toggle relay to select the bus as before creates a 16-port switch. There's no reason 3 or even 4 boards couldn't be connected this way. However, each board extends the signal path and will reduce performance at VHF frequencies. As you've seen, the TASS relay system is a very flexible and expandable solution for routing signals around a ham shack or laboratory. The TASS boards are now available from TAPR as kits, and you can order them at the URL shown here. The TASS-R kit is $119, and the TASS Shield kit is $19. Remember, you'll need to get the Arduino yourself. Both the TASS relay board and the TASS Shield use through-hole components, and they don't require any special assembly techniques. The Arduino software and other documentation are also available from TAPR at the second URL shown. Again, the software is open source, free for you to modify and use as you see fit. If you have any questions about the TASS system, please contact me at the email address shown here. I hope you'll find the TASS relay system to be as useful as I have. Thanks for taking the time to view this video.
That's it for this episode of Ham Radio Now. More TAPR stuff coming right away. If you enjoy the program or get something out of it, and you haven't contributed yet, especially because the Kickstarter didn't work, please stop by hamradionow.tv and click Arvin. That's Arvin sitting back there over my shoulder. Click his icon, and you can either join the Patreon and become a monthly contributor or just use PayPal and a major credit card through PayPal. You don't have to have a PayPal account at all and make an individual contribution. Appreciate those folks that have been doing that. It's been going pretty well this year, so thank you very much. But there's still plenty out there that are unable, that haven't done it so far. If you can't, if you know, your economic circumstances tell you that not a good idea to spend more money on something like that right now. You know, the holiday season, you got a lot of presents to buy and things like that. Don't worry about it. Just watch. We're doing okay. And catch us next year once you've caught up on the Christmas bills. Nobody else is going to tell you that. I'm Gary Pierce, KN4AQ73, over and out.